How is everybody tonight?
Great.
Yes.
Good. Great. I love the color. I love the energy. It's about to be finished. So every semester, at the end of the semester, we put our graduating class through fire. This is it.
True.
Tonight, they're going to showcase their business ideas. They're going to show their knowledge. They're going to show their presentation skills. And then by the end of the night, one team will win $250. They won't take it home tonight. They'll do it later on. So this course, this Capstone, Business Capstone course, comes at the end of the baccalaureate program. It's Bachelor's in Supervision and Management program. Students have gone through different disciplines of business in 4 years, and this is the culmination of their entire training. This is more of an academic exercise. They're not required to start a business, but guess what? We have at least one group who want to start business, another who may want to start business, may be thinking about it. We have others who are excited about their ideas. Right? So tonight is a night for showcasing the knowledge, and tonight is the night to have fun. This particular Business Capstone course focuses on social entrepreneurship. All four groups are focusing on solving a social or environmental issue. Well, all four of this class, they're focusing on social issues. We have amazing judges tonight. I'd like to introduce my friends, my colleagues and friends to everybody. We have Lynn Arguez. Chair of the Homestead Campus. Those of you who are, all of you are going through the BAS program, so you have seen Lynn at some point or another, right? Yes. Joyce Caff. For Goldman Sachs, 10,000 Small Businesses, and also the chair of Greater Kendall Business Association. Thank you. Thank you for being here. Anna Etienne. She's the program director for Food Incubator for Startup FIU. So we have the community, we have our partner, and we have our internal administrator present here. And we have some friends here as well. We have Sandra LaFleur from Innovation. Gustavo Grande, Program Manager and the Create Miami Director for Idea Center. Jorge Mendez, Teaching Fellow for Idea Center. And Nativa Kulitz, EI, from Earth Institute. Thank you all for coming. And Alexis Portuando, the great Alexis Portuando.
No title needed.
No title needed. So without further ado, I invite the Elevate U to present their business plan.
Okay, first and foremost, I'd like to thank everybody for being here with us today. A special thank you for Professor Hassan. You've done so much for us. I really appreciate everything you've done. From the bottom of my heart, without you, the vision wouldn't be there, so I appreciate that. Just to start off, my name is Christopher Gonzalez. I'm a student here at Miami-Dade College. I'm gonna be graduating this summer, supervision and management, with a degree in supervision and management, okay? This project has been a project we've been working on for a long time, putting in a lot of work. The original idea started about 6 years ago. I lost my friend due to a drug overdose. From that point on, I committed myself to come to school, to graduate, and to make a change and make a difference in the world. So I'm very, very excited to be here. That happened 6 years ago, and then I finally got the team together with the professor's help to bring it to life for you guys and for the world. Okay? My friend here, his name is Andrew Lee Perenio. Andy was my best friend, was my brother. He died, he was 18 years old. He died of an overdose from what's called fentanyl. How many people know what fentanyl is? There's a few. That's the problem. We're touching on the social issue. It's called drugs and alcohol. Okay? There's a really big issue with it, and in the presentation, we'll explain what we're gonna be doing about it. Okay? We're gonna explain how Andy's death relates to the business, and hopefully we make change, and hopefully this doesn't happen to one of your family members. Okay? We're just trying to save a life. So without further ado, let's get started. I'd like to introduce my team.
Hello, my name is Ariel Nunez. I'll be graduating next semester with a degree in supervision management.
Lourdes Bosas, I'll be graduating this fall with a degree in supervision and management.
Daniel Dossler, I'll be graduating this semester with a degree in supervision and management.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Michelle Arocha, but people know me by Missy, and I'll be graduating next spring with a degree in supervision and management as well.
Excellent. So as we said before, this might be the real deal. We'll be trying to bring this company to life for you summer of 2017. The company name, Elevate You. Oh.
Again, thank you all for being here. My name is Ariel Nunez, and I'm going to walk you through the social issue that we are facing. So in recent years, our country has seen a 300% increase in heroin use. In Miami-Dade County, that number is up to 120%. On your left, it shows the deaths in Florida by county with related to heroin. And as you see, the darker the red, the more cases they have. 9 times out of 10, Florida Medical Examiner reported that the cause of death for 634 cases was heroin. And on the right, you can see the rise in heroin deaths and fentanyl deaths, as Chris mentioned earlier. Fentanyl is a synthetic opioid that is 50 times stronger than heroin. As you see, this is a serious problem for South Florida. And we're gonna talk a little bit about how we're gonna fix this issue. On a national level, there are over 21 million Americans that suffer from substance abuse over the age of 12. There are over 140 annual deaths linked to drugs and alcohol. There are 17 million with a dependence on alcohol, 7 million using drugs on the daily, and 2.6 with a dependence on alcohol and drugs. So as you see, this is pretty scary, but at the end of the day, we do have a solution, and that is Elevate You. So what is Elevate You, and how are we going to make an impact? First, we want to offer an effective system that focuses on team building and accountability while still having fun and practicing good sportsmanship. In collaboration with Miami-Dade College, we want to host a post-rehab program for those dealing with substance abuse. And with a strong message and a lifetime support team, we feel that we can have an impact. So our vision. Our vision is to be the post-rehabilitation program of choice in South Florida for substance abuse. And our mission, aligned with our vision, is to create a post-rehabilitation program through the game of basketball that offers a fun way to be accountable and become a functioning member of society. And now I'll pass it over to Lourdes, who's gonna give you a little bit of information on the clinical studies that back our claim. Thank you.
Thank you, Ariel. So you've heard about Chris's story about Andy, very personal. You've also seen the numbers, which are staggering. Here in Miami-Dade alone, it has reached epidemic levels, going up fentanyl deaths in the amount of 310% alone. But there is good news. Substance abuse is treatable and can be successfully managed. Our program is based on clinical activity. As you all know, exercise is good for our bodies as well as our mind. When we exercise, our body releases endorphins. It also introduces good endorphins that gives our system that good feeling and that happy high that helps release stress. This is the same high that drug addicts experience, but at much higher level. Like I said, exercise releases stress, which is one of the drivers that leads these individuals to run towards the drugs. There have been numerous studies, and you can see some of them here on the screen, that have been published supporting the benefits of exercise on our target population. All of these studies have one thing in common, and that is that they all agree that exercise can be an effective treatment for those with a drug abuse problem. Articles published in the Scandinavian Journal of Health looked at 35 patients enrolled in a long-term residential facility, and they enrolled them in a 10-week moderate exercise program. At the end, they looked at and they showed improved quality of life, and they showed that they had reduced the intake of the drugs that they were taking prior to them entering the program. On the preclinical side, Biological Psychiatry, among other journals, published a study on rats that they had two groups of rats. So one group, both groups got cocaine. They were administered cocaine to both groups, but one group had exercise wheel. At the end of the study, they determined that the rats that had the exercise wheel experienced less brain damage and less craving for cocaine. The National Institute of Drug Abuse, NIDA, published an article titled "Physical Activity May Prevent Substance Abuse." In this article, they said, and I quote, "Exercise may promote overall well-being and protect against drug abuse and addiction." NIDA is committed to funding similar programs. However, there's not enough funding and there's not enough money. This is certainly an area with all the periodicals that have been published and all the articles that have been written that needs attention and more focus, and that we think that it should be looked at. Certainly the residential drug treatment programs have taken notice and are now providing some sort of exercise program in their daily activities for the residents. Ladies and gentlemen, we at Elevate You want to help participants in our program to fall in love with the game of basketball, or to create a habit of regular exercise, which as you can see could be crucial to their success in their aftercare program. Elevate You wants to be the coping mechanism that would help these participants remain clean and sober as they transition into the aftercare phase of their program. Thank you, and with that, I will turn it over to Missy.
Good evening, ladies. You heard Ariel speak of a problem and how Elevate You is going to influence change in the South Dade community. With a strong message, we can have a positive impact in the community together with Miami-Dade College. Lourdes just provided you with proven facts. She provided clinical studies that emphasize on how important it is to exercise during rehab and during post-recovery. inpatient facilities recommend that all patients dedicate time to physical activity because exercising helps with clearing the mind, it boosts the heart rate, and promotes overall good physical and mental health. These studies have led this group to come up with the social entrepreneurship idea of Elevate You. I am here to tell you why you should choose us. Choose us because if you look at the chart on this slide, we are the only company that offers a cost-effective way of receiving post-rehab therapy, such as group and individual counseling, that offers time flexibility with a physical exercise program. Compared to the competitors whose program costs approximately over $2,500. That's double the price anyone would pay for, whereas Elevate You, you will receive 3 months of exercise and healthy therapy for only $1,500. Our competitors offer other means of post-recovery rehab programs, such as the company Inspire Recovery Group, which creates a safe space for personal expression through art, writing, and music-based groups. Now, let's look at another competitor, Water Edges Recovery. Their focus is helping those find employment and build rapport on how to build professional resumes. As you can see from this slide and from our overall presentation, the South Dade community has a need, a social need to impact those in our community to continue a healthy and enriched lifestyle while exercising and playing the game of basketball. Most importantly, our program will promote a social sober network commitment. So whether you are out shooting hoops by yourself, playing a game of basketball with a group of people, basketball is a great way to get fit, stay in shape, and reduce stress while building confidence among many things. Yes, we all can agree that there are many programs in the area today that offer a basketball program in the community, but none of them provide the functionality of creating a unique experience that will offer substance abusers a second chance of continued recovery. And now I'm turning this over to Ariel for information on the daily operations of the business.
Thank you, once again. So, like she said, it's gonna be a 3 month basketball program. So it'll be 5 days a week, 4 hours a day, and that's not including game day. So it'll begin with signing in, and we'll have a group talk. It'll be 50 minutes of motivating, opening the lines of communication for the players, and also game planning for the coaches to get them ready for the day. After that, we'll go into warm-ups for 20 minutes. Short, sweet. Go on to basketball drills for 40 minutes. Well, they'll learn the fundamentals of the game and also get them ready to compete. And they'll also have the coaches a chance to pull the players out for a little one-on-one coaching. From there, we'll have a practice scrimmage game. It'll be 30 minutes. It'll get them prepared for game day. Also know for them to know what to expect when the day comes. Then we'll go back to a group talk. Well, they'll be given improvements. They'll be motivated and they'll be pushed to keep working harder. Afterwards, we'll have an hour of free time, open to family and friends, gives the participants a chance to seek one-on-one support and also get nutritional information or anything else they're looking for. So like we said, it's a 3 month basketball program. We'll have an open house and orientation, which you'll hear about shortly. There'll be weekly random drug testing. There'll be one-on-one support from coaches, as we said, team drills, an official weekly basketball game, and we'll be creating a lifetime support group. Now I'll pass it over to Chris with the marketing strategy. Thank you.
Right, thank you, Ariel. So, market strategy, who and how many? So basically, we're gonna be going after individuals who need our help. Individuals who want help, but don't know probably where to go. They can come to us, okay? We're also gonna be reaching out to people that are in rehab, okay? People who are just finished rehab, this is their post-rehab. This is to continue those efforts. Okay, to stay sober, to stay clean. Okay, we'll be reaching out to other members of the community. We'll be reaching out to colleges, to schools, in order to create business, in order to get people involved into the program. Okay, What we're gonna be doing is we're gonna start with two teams of 10, and then work and build from there. Okay. So our target market breakdown: there are 27,000 individuals in rehab from the ages 12 to 66. There are 15,000 individuals from ages 18 to 35 years old. So as you can see, we're breaking down and going into that's our target market. Okay, we only need to penetrate the market only 0.04% in order to make an impact. Okay, so out of the 15,000, we only need 0.04 to gain sustainability. Okay, this is pretty much a breakdown of our open house and our marketing recruitment process. We're going to be reaching out to individuals on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. We all know that social media is the new wave. Individuals probably don't even have television nowadays, so you know the marketing for social media has to be there through bloggers, through team efforts. What we're going to do is, once you hear about us, we want to bring you in. We're going to have an orientation towards the end of the month, like Ariel was saying earlier. At the orientation, we'll talk about registrations, we'll sign forms, go through the legal process, and we'll talk and discuss payments, and then we'll game plan for the future. Okay, open house is at the end of every month, like I just said. And go ahead, next slide. And what we're going to be charging $1,500 per person for the three-month program. We're going to make sure that they have a mandatory minimum hours that they meet in the program, which is going to be 264 hours within the 3 months. If you break it down, it's only 568 an hour, okay? 568 an hour for mentors and open gym, coaches. All this is what we're bringing and providing to our customers in order to make an impact. Of course, as game day as well. These numbers are subjected to change depending on where we're going to be located. And I'm going to give it to Daniel for the financials.
Good evening, everybody. Let's have some fun and talk about money. For the judges, grill me a little bit. So these are the startup costs. It just goes over the licenses, equipment, salaries, and with 3 months of expense for emergency money, it's just under $39,000. So that makes it relatively pretty cheap to start up. These are financial highlights by year. Year one, revenue and expenses and costs are pretty much tied, but after that, revenue starts breaking away and you start to see the green, and that's our net profit. We have it staying still because we want to cap out at 50 people in the league for every 3 months for the sake of size. And so yeah, we're starting with 20 and we're adding a team of 10 every 3 months. And that's seen through here, revenue by month. Every 3 months, you see a little bit of a gain with that extra team. Expenses by month, as we grow, expenses grow with it. Financial highlights, year one, we start off below. We're not making any profit, we're losing some money, but after that, once we hit 36 people, which is our break even, we start to swing up into the net profit, and that's that green right there. This is a profit and loss statement. As you can see, year one, we're not making that much money. We're losing $823, just under $1,000, with $210,000 in revenue. After that, we reach our max, $300,000, and then we hit that nice 16% net profit. And we're getting $47,000 around there. And then as we're paying down our interest, we're getting a little bit more money over time. That includes all our expenses, which we could go over more later. Projected balance sheet, in balance, we all love that. Total assets equal total liabilities and equity. As you can see, our biggest asset is cash. We don't have any like real long-lasting assets other than like computers and equipment. But as you can see, our assets are going up, our liabilities are going down. Hopefully we could become debt-free and be really heavy in the equity side and very low on the liabilities. This is the projected cash flow. So this just basically tells you what's changing year by year. We get the net income, it goes through, we have the sales tax that caps off and it doesn't change after that because we're staying at that 50 people. As far as income tax, they're gonna be taxed personally, so it's not reflected in any of the balance sheets. change in long-term debt is decreasing until we become debt-free, and change in short-term debt increases a little bit year by year until we completely knock it out. As you can see, cash at the beginning of the period, zero, what's left over, and then it moves on, and we're just building that up. That's just based off, scared. So that's based off of us keeping the money. We could do whatever we want with the money. We could give it back. We could invest more into the future. We could expand. Now Missy's gonna talk about the impact metrics.
Okay, this slide presents you with our impact metrics. The impact metrics defines how Elevate U can measure our social success in society. Now Elevate U will measure our social success by the percentage of participants that remain drug-free and after the program, and the pre and post skills evaluation and employment status. Now I'm gonna turn it over to Chris for some final words.
Well, I hope you enjoyed our presentation. This is Elevate U. This is what we're gonna be bringing to you guys soon, hopefully summer 2017. This is much bigger than just the game of basketball. We're really trying to push for a social change in society. So we just want to make sure that families don't feel pretty much what I felt that day, okay? It's not a good feeling, so if we could do and save one life, that goes a long way. So once again, thank you for being here with us today, and we're going to open up the floor for questions.
We have 8 minutes for questions, and judges, I have a request for you. While you ask the questions, please keep the score for, you know, Elevate U. Thank you.
All right, I guess I'll jump in. That was really quite impressive. I'm really sorry to hear about your friend, Chris. That really sort of touched me. The information and the research I thought was pretty good in terms of what's going on with the drugs. I know there's been a lot in the news recently too as well. So certainly it is a very good thing for you guys to be doing this, and I think it's a great cause. I was concerned about a 3-month program. What happens after 3 months?
I could answer that question.
Okay.
So after 3 months, they like graduate, and we keep up with them. They could come back to us for support. We'll call them. Our whole entire idea of the impact metrics is to make sure that they get employed. This tells us that like our program's working, and then they could also come back and work part-time as a coach. And we pay our coaches $16 an hour, so they'll make back the money that they spent on the program in the first month of working too.
In addition to that, yeah, after they graduate and go through the program, we want them to come back. We want them to coach. We want them to mentor. We want them to show that the program works and to get the word out. We want to bring people back in, and we don't want to charge them again. You know, they've already gone through the program. They know what it is. They gotten the information, which is probably the biggest thing. So we're there to support and help and make sure that they stay on that track too.
Just as a bit of follow-up, is there an opportunity, say, for instance, to have a sort of subscription where they could be a part of this club,
yeah,
and they could just come by to play basketball?
That's the idea in the future.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Right now with Miami-Dade College, we're a little limited on our time, but in the future we would like to open up our own facility and have them come in without limits.
That's the benefit of this program, is that there's so much opportunity. Like, there's a lot of ideas that I've spoken to a few different people, but, you know, for the sake of the project, you know, we're just, you know, just 3-month program, you could always come back.
Also, Chris, please share with us, you spoke to high school,
So I went to a high school just to present and pitch the idea, work on my pitch, work on bringing customers in, you know, just brainstorming, right? And when I was doing it, it turns out that, you know, I told one person who told a friend, right? And before I knew it, I had 10 people like, oh, is it open up? When can we go play basketball? Let's sign up. Like, I kind of felt like an overload. There's too many people at that point. That's why we ended up capping off at 50, because we make it exclusive, make it unique, and make it real.
Christopher, again, I share your sympathy with your friend. I had a family friend that lost his son to heroin this fall, so I know exactly that there is a problem,
yeah,
and that you definitely addressed a problem within this community.
Yes.
So I applaud you for your courage in doing so. I do have a few questions. When doing your research, did you consult with any psychologists or psychiatrists?
Mm-hmm. Can you answer that?
Sure. As a matter of fact, my son, I tutors with an educational psychologist, and just by chance, I mentioned this program, and she happens to be a certified
CMDP.
Addiction professional. So she has a certification in CAP, and she is ready to go with Elevate You from day one. So she will be on board working with us from that moment.
That was my first question. My second question is the number that you have there, the 27,814.
That's based in Florida.
It's based in Florida,
yeah,
not Miami-Dade.
Yeah.
Okay, it's Florida. That was my question. And then also my other question was, have you thought about maybe partnering with some of the hospitals that do drug treatment really well? I know South Miami has a really good drug treatment program. Have you thought about that?
Yeah, well, that was actually, I did speak about that a little bit. We want to partner up with different organizations. So depending on the organization, you know, we can't go maybe not to an elementary school, but we could definitely go to, you know, Baptist. We could definitely go to maybe like a Lowell's. You know, there's different companies that have employees, and if they want to take care, maybe this could be like a benefit to the employees as well. So there's a lot of different ideas. There's a lot of different opportunities. That we can go ahead and take that.
And what about training for your coaches as far as being mental health counselors? Did you think about that?
Yeah, well,
we want to get experienced people who have had some kind of history and just want like a part-time job to help. So like more than like what they can teach in basketball, like that's what we're looking to hire, is someone who has that strong background in history.
And my uncles come from a coaching background, so when it comes to coaching, you know, elementary school kids, middle school kids, high school kids, college individuals, like I have a team of coaches that know the game, that can teach the game, and I could always bring them in one person at a time, depending on who we can get involved with the company. Maybe an NBA player or two would like to speak. I know we have a few different mentors.
We're looking at the opportunity of bringing in Miami-Dade basketball players here in the college to help mentor and help be part of the project.
And then also one more thing.
One more question.
Yeah. We don't want to cross the line of being a rehab program. We're a post-rehab program, so we don't, like, if someone like drops for something, we're calling 911. We're a follow-up program.
We're not doctors. We're not going to be prescribing medications. We're not. If a doctor tells you this is what you need to take, guess what? Take that.
Right.
You know? But if you're trying to sober up, you don't want to drink every weekend, hey, maybe you could come in and play some basketball and we'll.
As mentioned in the presentation, we want to provide a sober network for those in the program so that they can share similar interests with amongst each other.
All right, I'll make it quick. I got a minute and 26 seconds. All right, I just wanted to clarify your business model. So your business to business and your business to customer as well, you're both. And Lynn touched on rehabilitation hospitals, but they're actually for-profit centers. Would you consider brokering or contracting yourself out to these centers where you may not provide the 3-month package deal, but let's say their group that's living in their facility could come for a few hours?
I wouldn't see why not.
That's actually an opportunity.
Yeah. I wouldn't see why not.
After conducting a SWOT analysis,
right.
That's an opportunity.
Capping yourself, looking at your numbers, you like in 2020, you're grossing $47,000, which isn't a lot. Mm-hmm. Right.
Well, they're capped because of the space. Time limit in the basketball
regarding,
field.
Right.
Maybe.
So,
right.
But they're not playing basketball all the time.
Exactly.
So there's a lot of wasted time where the space isn't being utilized. So in addition to this particular model, so you're getting the most out of your facility.
Of course.
You know, I'd say consider rehabilitation centers that are dealing with the addicts at the present time,
where they're responsible for the counseling, mm-hmm. they're responsible for overseeing, they're just coming to you for the resource regarding exercise.
That's a good idea.
Great.
That's a great idea. I would not be opposed to that. The whole idea is to bring as many people as possible.
Correct.
You know?
And we
so
have a meeting set up on the Monday to talk to the basketball coaches to see the availability of the space.
And actually, we ran in on our film. We ran into the coaches. And let me tell you, I've not seen somebody more enthusiastic. Like, I'm enthusiastic about this project. It's our project, you know. But this lady was like she made me want to join the like she was so enthusiastic about it. She knows what she's talking about. She's an Olympian, a medalist. You know what I'm saying?
Ex-police officer.
She knows her stuff, and I was very excited that. She's a resource right there in our backyard.
Absolutely.
And we have a lot of talent here in Miami, so the more people that we can bring in and can be part of this program, the better it's gonna be for everybody.
Right. I think that might solve that particular issue, because if you're gonna be hiring counselors, this is not a cheap person
yeah.
when they're qualified. And then you want 3 cohorts a year, which is a lot. So financially, it would be helpful if you had additional resources to bring in that funding to pay for that. I didn't see anything in your budget regarding staff,
mm-hmm.
right? And so, is it gonna be all volunteers?
No, they're like we in the budget. We do have a salary, and that's based off of a coach per team at $16 an hour. 4 hours, it's like a part-time job. 4 hours a day, 5 days a week. For the coach, yeah. And then.
And what about you guys?
These two are getting paid $36,000 a year.
Okay.
And the rest of us are consultants.
And then we're advisors.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
These are very good feedback.
Okay.
So because since they're into launch, they need to have this kind of feedback.
Yeah.
Well, that's the point, and that's why it's so important for everybody to be here today. Like I said, it's not a project that is, we've been working very long, very hard, but it's a project that I've been wanting for years and years and years and years. And the fact that we're able to bring it to you, I mean, that's all I want is to perfect it and make sure it's ready so that when it launches, we'll be good enough to go.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank
you,
everybody.
Bye.
Thank you for being here.
Okay. So our next group, and this possibility, there are dog lovers. And the kids are
like 18 is a magical age for most youth, but not for foster children. At 18, foster children are kicked out of the system to fend for themselves. In Miami alone, there are 125 such youth. Of the 125, 22% will be homeless for one day. One in four.
Endless Possibilities is an LLC. It serves as a full service dog training, boarding, and grooming facility that hires foster care children about to age out of the foster care system. By working with Endless Possibilities, we are providing the youth with marketable job skills for their future. Good evening. My name is Diane Piñate. I'm president and CEO of Endless Possibilities. Frida Holler is vice president and CMO. Michael Haynes is CFO and CIO. Yvette Almaguer is CCO and COO. 28,000 children, foster care children nationally, will age out of foster care this year. Out of those 28,000 foster care children, 125 can be found in Miami-Dade County, Florida. Of the 125 in Miami-Dade County, Florida, 22% will be homeless for at least one day. Research shows that interaction between dogs and people have physiological and psychological benefits. For example, physiological, it lowers blood pressure, and people that have suffered heart attacks tend to live longer. Psychological, it reduces depression, it teaches patience and commitment, and it also produces long-term behavior changes. How can Endless Possibilities help these foster children? The foster children come to work at Endless Possibilities, and they learn to groom and handle the dogs. They learn how to train and manage. They learn customer care skills as well as organizational skills, and they learn to have ethical work habits and social responsibility. While they're doing this, they're also gaining sales experience. The services that Endless Possibilities provides are doggy daycare, slumber party, which is boarding, grooming, and training. The training that Endless Possibilities offers, and it's the youth that are training the dogs, are both individual and group obedience training. The service dog aspect of the training is to help disabled persons with tasks that they cannot do for themselves, and also provide medical alert, and also psychiatric and emotional support. So it will help people that have PTSD, as well as children that have autism, and give them comfort. And now let's see what's happening in the market.
Esteemed judges, professor, and ladies and gentlemen, Endless Possibilities' main business is in pet care, and the outlook for this market is very bright indeed. According to the American Pet Products Association, there are 65% of U.S. households own pets, and the total pet expenditure in 2016 is projected to reach over $62 billion. And even though that most of the expenditure goes to pet food, spending on training and boarding will reach almost $6 billion this year. And in the Miami-Dade County, ladies and gentlemen, there are over 300,000 homes with dogs. And within a 5-mile radius of Endless Possibilities location, there are around or over 9,000 homes with dogs. And this number funnels down to our target market of almost 3%. And because Endless Possibilities will train foster care children to become dog trainers and service professionals, we also look into the job prospects in the pet care industry. And as you can see from the chart, the U.S. Bureau of Labor forecasts until 2024, until the year 2024, an 11% faster than average growth in employment for animal service professionals and dog trainers. And now we're going to look at our competition. As you can see from the slide, PetSmart, one of the largest U.S. retailers of pet care products, is one of our competitors. And they do offer boarding, training and boarding. And like our other competitors, they either only have training and boarding, or they only offer daycare and grooming. Unlike us, endless possibilities. We are more of a full service dog care business, offering training, boarding, daycare, and grooming. And most important of all, we are one of the very few dog care businesses that actually can be considered a socially responsible enterprise. And next, we'll take a look at our operations.
Okay, so how are we gonna do this? We're going to hire foster care children between the ages of 16 and 18 that are going to age out of the system. We are going to train them on how to groom dogs, how to handle a spa, how to properly train the dogs, how to offer boarding, how to offer the daycare. By offering these children these different trainings, we're providing them with lifelong marketable job skills that will allow them to be self-sufficient and allow them to have opportunities for the rest of their lives. At the same time, we're going to be working with rescue dogs. So we will go to the shelters and rescue dogs, in which we will train them on obedience and then specialize them in different types of trainings and services based on their personalities, on their characteristics, and their abilities. Once we have these service dogs trained, we will be selling them to individuals who require service dogs for various reasons. If an individual cannot afford to purchase a service dog because they are very expensive, then we will, if they meet our criteria, donate the service dog to them. For every 5 service dogs that we sell, we will provide one of our trainees with a college scholarship, allowing them to obtain a college degree. So we have the trainees and the foster children learning the life skills. We have the dogs being able to be trained and find a home. Meanwhile, as all this process is underway, they are providing therapy to one another because they have one common thing. They've both been abandoned, both the children and the dogs, and they help each other out because with the dogs, there's no walls that need to be up. The therapy is immediate. So how's it gonna work? Well, you will call up our center, go onto our website, or just show up and sign your dog up for a service. Once the dog arrives, the dog will be inspected to make sure that there's no lesions or he's not injured or that he's in optimal shape. If we find anything, we will document it on the inspection document. The person who's dropped off the dog will sign off on it as well, and one of our trainees will come and get the dog. If the trainee has been fully trained on the service that the dog is signed up for, then they will perform the service on the dog. If they are not fully trained, then they will take the dog to work with another fully trained individual or with one of the specialists and continue their training. Once the dog is done with their service, they'll be taken to a waiting area, and the training individual will go in and on their iPad note that the dog, his service is complete. From there, they will verify if there's any other services that the dog is waiting for. If they are, they'll make sure that the dog is scheduled on time and the dog can just stay in the play area waiting. If the dog is finished with all the services it's been signed up for, then the dog will be returned to their owner. So how are we gonna get this business out there? Through our marketing. We are gonna market through Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. We are going to use our website and have search engine optimization. One of our major strategies is Groupon. We believe that through Groupons, we will be able to bring in a lot of clients. We plan on working with Republica, one of the fastest growing marketing firms in South Florida, for them to help us identify what is the best go-to-market strategy to optimize our services and bring in the most clientele. Another thing that for us is very important is our reputation. One of the best ways to get our business out there is through happy, satisfied customers. When they're happy and they're satisfied with the job we've done, they will tell their friends and families and recommend our business. Another thing that's really gonna help us is our location, because the visibility will allow individuals to see where we are and see what we are.
So I'm gonna let you guys tilt your head this way now so you don't get a stiff neck. Like the word from this side. So our location is just north of the Palmetto, between two major avenues, 57th and 67th Ave. It is facing the Palmetto, so all that traffic going by will see our signage every day. It's 3,100 square feet of office and warehouse space, and the location has the bus stops right there on the corner so that the foster care youth have a way to get to the business for their job. We have a good lease on this property. It's $2,600 a month, and as we noted earlier, there's like 9,700 households with dogs within 5 miles of our location. So let's talk a little bit about our numbers. So we have five revenue streams. I've broken down the fixed costs of the business across all five of the streams. For the grooming and training, we have direct costs, and for grooming, we have our supplies for the dog grooming that's gonna be variable per unit. When you work out the numbers, most of the numbers come out, our break-even units are 50% of our overall capacity. Our biggest opportunity comes in the daycare, where our capacity has the potential to make us a lot of money. So there's a lot of detail on these financial pages. I'm going to highlight in the middle of the page here, you see the industry averages for this business. For the gross margin, it's 95%, and we come in close at about 83%. The operating margin for the industry is 11, and even though the number's not up there, when you do the math, ours is at 13%. And the net income percentage for the industry is 7, and we're well over 10% for our net profit on our projections. Now, the way that we came up with the revenue, the projected revenue for this, is I took 70% of our capacity and did the numbers based on that. Over here you see the expenses that we have. Some of them are startup expenses. Some of them are going to continue year over year. Over here you see the assets that we had to purchase to start the business up. One of the interesting things that we've decided to purchase through startup are the kennel cameras. So the customers will be able to actually interact with their dogs while they're in daycare or boarding, including these units have a way to dispense a treat, so they can actually give their dog a treat from remote while they're interacting with their dogs. I think it's one way that we might differentiate ourselves from our competitors. On this side, we talk about our staff. We are gonna have two certified behavioral trainers, two professional groomers, two boarding coordinators. As far as the owners are concerned, two of us are going to be full-time managing the business, and two of us are going to work part-time, take a part-time salary. And then we have the salary here for the part-time trainees, and we plan to have eight students part-time working in the business for an overall total of 18 employees. We talk about the cash flow and balance sheet. When we look at this, our goal is to take a look at the numbers and reinvest our profits back for the first 3 years of the business and figure out how we want to work with the funds after that, once we have a better handle on how the business is going to operate. So in order for us to start up, we need $50,000. That's for the construction costs, that's for the supplies, that's for the equipment, that's for the technology that we need to buy. In order to do that, we looked at a small business loan, and we can get a small business loan to pay back over 10 years with a $560 monthly payment, an interest rate of 6.25%, and an APR of 7.31%, including fees. And so now, why do we want to do this business?
So as we said, in South Florida, 125 foster care children will turn 18 and age out of the program. Of these children, 1 in 5 will be homeless for at least a day. Half of them will not have a job by the age of 24. Less than 3% will obtain a college degree. 71% of the young women will be pregnant by the age of 21. And 1 in 4 will suffer from post-traumatic stress disorder. How can we hope to make an impact? First and foremost, we start endless possibilities. We give these children an avenue where they can get the power back in their lives, where they can start a career, where they can learn skills that they'll have forever. We're going to start off, as Michael had said, with hiring 8 trainees. 8 is the initial magic number. That number may change. As the business grows, we may have capacity for more. As turnover rates, we don't know what the turnover rates will be, so that will also determine how many children we're able to fully train. Of these children, as we had said, with the selling of the 5 dogs, they will receive a scholarship for college. So once they're done with their training, they will go to college if they choose to. And they can study whatever they like. There's no restrictions on what they study. So they get a college degree, they can continue working with us, or they can go off on their own, but at least they have the ability to sustain themselves for a lifetime. The other option is school isn't for everyone. So those children that choose not to go to school but show an entrepreneurial spirit or have shown responsibility and maturity, we will help them start a franchise of endless possibilities, a mobile franchise. And we will give them the tools that they need in order to be successful. And we will also help them fund it with a payback program. We know we're not going to be able to help every single foster child, but through the scholarships that we're offering, we're going to be able to reduce the number that don't go to college. Then with these young women, by giving them the opportunity to be self-sufficient and for them to be able to have careers and salaries that they could sustain themselves, they may not have to move in with the first guy they meet. So we're hoping to reduce the pregnancy percentages that are out there. And for those suffering from PTSD, they work with these dogs, they receive therapy by working with these dogs. So we're hoping that the long-term effects of the PTSD that they have will not be as significant. By doing this, we have already provided these children with endless possibilities. Thank you. Any questions?
Okay, so we have 8 minutes.
I'll go first. No, that was really great. I feel like you have a model that could actually happen. This could be a win if you guys decide to really do this. I do have a few questions, though. When it came to the cost of what it would take for you to start, you mentioned washer, dryer, computer, desk, and the camera. But have you visited your competitors?
Yes.
Because your competitors who have these shops have more than that. They have like a realistic version of the outdoors indoors and what that's going to cost you to recreate. In addition to grooming products and all these other issues or liability potential issues that you may have to deal with per, you know, dog that comes in when it comes to your B2C client, right? So that's something to...
We have gone to that level of detail. We in our numbers, we actually have the asphalt to make it look real. We have the construction cost that goes into exactly that. Our cost, we have it down to how much each shampoo will cost per dog. So we went out and we researched from our competitors how many ounces they use of shampoo, of conditioner for the pets, and so forth. So we did go into that level of detail. Okay.
So that's gonna be all in here, mm-hmm. which is great. I'll take a look. My other question is in regards to the foster care children, 16 to 18. Do you know what the legal responsibilities are? Will the foster system allow you to reach out to these young men and women? What's the actual process? Because being that they're living in foster care, I'm sure there's transportation issues, and I'm sure there's also legal issues as to what they can do when. Has that been discussed?
Yes, okay. Actually we did. Our professor's good. She's grinding us. So yes, we did actually address both of those issues. I have spoken to different organizations. We also went into, I spoke to an attorney to find out what the legal ramifications were of hiring a foster care child within that age group. Yes, we can hire them, so far as we have to have written legal consent from the foster care parent or the program that they're in.
Okay.
And as far as their transportation, you will see on our financials that we are offering them bus passes. It is their responsibility to use those bus passes. If they lose the bus passes, they need to purchase them.
Also location.
And our location, we also set it in an area where it's close enough that the children can reach us easily.
Okay, that is awesome. Last question, the scholarship, is it a full scholarship? Is it a partial scholarship? Have you selected a school that this would be designated to? Because, I mean, you said every five dogs, it would be the one scholarship. But that depends on, you know, financially which school they go to.
Correct.
The prices are different.
Absolutely. The school is Miami-Dade.
Okay.
And as far as the scholarship, we would like to make it a full scholarship. But we need to go further into the details of seeing exactly what the cost is going to be and exactly how much we're going to make and sustain the cost of the service dogs.
One key thing on the service dog training, it takes about 2 years to fully train a service dog. So you won't see any revenue in our financials that has anything to do that you see there with the service dog.
Okay.
Because by the time we get these dogs trained, the cost, the price, all of that stuff is going to fluctuate. And so we know that the revenue could be very good. And so we just need to work out the numbers
that work for that. The police department have retired dogs that are trained, which would cut down on that time as well.
Yeah.
Oh, that's great. We didn't know that.
That's awesome.
So that's great feedback. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, I don't know. I certainly want to commend you too as well. I think that's awesome. I think it's a real good, fabulous business opportunity that you have. And I think you've done quite a bit of work in sort of fleshing it out and seeing what's there. There are a couple of points that I also would underscore what Anna said, because I certainly agreed on the competition side of it. I'm not sure if we can just sit and, you know, a lot of stuff will come to you. I think the competition has been doing a lot of stuff, and I think it's useful to check in on that too as well. And I know you had a list of all of that. One of the things I wanted to talk about is developing the foster care students, because the background, I'm not sure what sort of background they're coming to you with, and it's almost as if you need additional professional development or training for these people that would not be just the regular, let me hire somebody off the road, they're expected to, you know, work to this level. But I wasn't sure if you have built in any additional sort of professional training or anything else, psychological or anything else that would be required for this level of persons.
Well, I did speak to a mental health specialist. She's actually an advisor at South Miami Senior High, and she works with a lot of foster care children. I also spoke to Rosa Maria Plasencia from Amigos for Kids and Marcel Rivas of US Kids Work. And I was told, basically, you're absolutely right. These children will come with all types of different needs and requirements. But that's one of the main reasons why we selected to work with dogs. Because research has shown that working with the dogs helps deal with a lot of these issues. And also, it gives the child a link to want to go back because of the relationship they've built with those dogs that are being trained. Not to work with us, but to work with the dogs, because they create that bond. With the dogs, the child doesn't have to talk. They don't have to open up. It's a slow transition. The same thing as the dog. When they first get there, the dog is scared. We don't know if it's been abused. We don't know what it's gone through. So definitely they will grow together. We will not be providing any kind of psychological support or anything like that. We are going to have professional staffers that it would be a good idea, to your point, to maybe give them some kind of psychological training on dealing with foster children. That we haven't incorporated, but that's some very good feedback.
Thank
you.
I have other questions, but I want to leave some time.
No, you can go ahead. I just have one comment, so go ahead and ask your question. I commend you. I think this is a great idea. The comment that I had is maybe you have the foster care piece, but I would also even like you to bring in the vet piece, the veterans.
We were going to do that, and the professor has suggested
because that is a perfect fit for this, because you can even have vets come in and volunteer, not pay them. And that would be another opportunity to do the social entrepreneurship piece that's free, you know, because a lot of vets just need somewhere to go. And they could come in as volunteers, and that would, I think, even add more value to your company.
That's excellent, because we had thought about when we were talking about donating the service dogs to those who need, mm-hmm. we had thought, and the professor had mentioned, to work with the vets.
Right.
So definitely that was something we were going to do.
And
but
a lot of
your suggestion of bringing them in, they have
service.
A certain discipline,
right.
and they have a certain training that they can pass on to these foster care children, mm-hmm. which would be excellent. That's
yeah.
great.
Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions?
From multicultural communities like yours, hand-picked artisans have partnered with us to offer authentic artwork, handicrafts, dresses, satchels, and more that remind you of home in a single place. Familiar, feito a mão, close to you, this is Artisan.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Mark Ackley. I'm the president and CEO of the company, Artisans, and this is our team.
My name is Mariana Barrios. I'm the chief operating officer and vice president of education.
I'm Ariel Caesar. I'm chief technology officer.
My name is Manuel Horta, and I'm chief marketing officer.
And good evening. My name is Rafael Portuondo. I'm the vice president of sales and chief financial officer. I'm the one that gets to try on all this stuff, show this stuff off to you guys, and tell you a little bit about it. So the weekend's coming up, right? It's supposed to be very nice. I want to go to the beach, maybe put a little bit of color to your wardrobe for that night or for that day. Maybe you're entertaining or having friends, family coming in from Colombia, Venezuela, Cuba, Puerto Rico. This artisan here can personalize this piece for however how you're feeling that day or who you're inviting. These pieces are actually interchangeable. They can come off if you, depending on who you're hosting that night or just how you're feeling that day. What we see here and we see on that table is we see art, we see passion, we see people who are pouring their heart and souls into the products that they love and try to share it with the rest of the world.
So when coming up with business ideas, I met an artisan in Pompano Beach, and she was Brazilian, and she was selling some very particular items. And I made a connection to them because I'm from Brazil. So I understood the story that was being told through those objects. And so I began a conversation with her. And she informed me that she was a mother of three, and her whole income was producing and selling these products, and she also received welfare. So as we continued our conversation, she informed me that she did not sell them online because she did not have a computer, and also she only spoke Portuguese. Therefore, this was another barrier she was facing in this country. Now, all of us here come from a Latino background, so we were able to make a connection with people, relatives, friends, we know, who all have great skills in diverse areas, but due to some of these issues, they're not able to grow in this country. So we're here to try to help these people.
So what is it that we're gonna do? Well, we're gonna open up a website and name it artisans.com. And what it's gonna be, it's gonna be an online marketplace for these people to come in and sell all their handmade goods and art. Our aim is to preserve the intangible cultural heritage in our beautiful city. How are we gonna do that? Well, we're gonna not only sell to the general public, such as yourselves, we're also gonna target businesses, large businesses such as cruise lines and wedding planners, so that these artisans can sell their items in bulk and grow their brand. And we're also gonna help each one-on-one by offering in-person workshops where they can become better entrepreneurs themselves. So at Artisans, our vision is to connect the art of the world to the local market and beyond. Our mission is to bring the culture from all around the globe closer to home. By creating a community-centered environment, we will use the power of art to bring the rest of the world to you. Through our values, we are committed to helping better our world with our markets, our customers, and with our artisans. So who is it that we're trying to help? Well, our actions are going to help those people who come from other countries and have a certain set of skills that they just can't market in today's business place. We're gonna give them a place to sell online and make a living for themselves. We're also looking to impact those people who can connect with an item, an art, whether it be because of their ethnicity, their tourist, or because they just appreciate handmade items. William Foote on Forbes magazine once said that people nowadays care more about where an item came from and its story than what the product itself is.
Good evening. Now that my colleague Mariano has spoken a bit on our beneficiaries, I want to talk to you a bit about our consumers and where we're getting our money from. To begin with, we're going to only work out of Miami-Dade County and Broward County. In between those two places, there makes up about a little over 100 zip codes, and in between those places, we have a little over 1.5 million households. Now, these households spend $24 and $61 per year, respectively, on women's and men's accessories and arts and crafts, which total up to about a cash flow of $140 million, and we aim to take about 1% for our cash stream, our revenue stream. Now, if the title weren't put aptly enough, many small businesses have little to no online presence. Tess Townsend says that about 60% of small businesses that are made up of 1 to 5 people, very much like our artisans, they don't have any online presence. They don't sell online. And of that 60%, 12%, only 12, have a Facebook page. I mean, I think that's a little shocking. My grandmother has a Facebook page. Now, Blake Irving, he's the CEO of GoDaddy Incorporated. He said that while we take for granted that everyone is online, the reality is that for many small businesses, it's simply not true. In addition to that, another survey says that 83% of businesses that have a website online say that they have a competitive advantage over businesses that do not. And that's what we want to give our artisans. We want to give them a distinct competitive advantage.
Okay, so when we select this business, our main question was, where will we find these artisans? Can they produce the amount of products we would need? So we decided to do a search in the zip code 33176 to have an idea of the size of the market. And we were surprised that in 2016, there were over 49 fairs selling handcraft items spread in all these different locations. And they were diverse fairs with different topics, and there were thousands of artisans participating in these fairs.
All right, so let me talk to you about our market test. So what we did, we visited some different fairs where different artisans are present, and what we did, we talked to them as we went to these fairs like Bayfront Park, and once we did that, we found out exactly how many of them actually sell online, how many of them would benefit from selling online, as well as how many of them have had difficulty starting their business. Some of the responses we got from them, for example, the one that really stood out to me was Carrie from Costa Rica saying, I sell a few products online through Facebook. If someone were to create a website, I would definitely be on board, which really is the whole basis of why we decided to go with this business. All right, so let me also talk to you about our volume buyers. What we're gonna do, we're gonna contact the purchasing departments for different cruise liners and wedding planners. We're gonna sign the specific contracts that we need to do in order to start the process. Once we do that, we're gonna arrange a meeting with them and pitch the products that we're gonna be selling through them. And then we're gonna have sign the agreements to get started with them. Okay, so aside from the traditional Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest, and Facebook, we're also gonna use our business cards to market ourselves. So these are the ones that the artisans would be passing out in their fairs when they, or anywhere for that matter. And it's gonna have our website name as well as our email. And what that's gonna do is it's gonna help attract traffic to us. Now you probably could see from the business cards, there's a blank space on them. What those blank spaces for, so the actual artisan could put their brand on the card. Okay, so we also visited some fairs. We saw a bunch of tents. Really, there was no brand, no signage, really nothing that really stood out and said, you know. And then so what we're gonna do, we're gonna add their brand to the tent as well as we're gonna add our website name on their tents. That way they could better brand themselves, and then when they give out their business cards, they could see what exactly they're all about. Also, if you look now, we have one tent obviously with a branding and the others don't really have anything. Which one do you rather go to now?
All right, so as I mentioned in the beginning, one of the things that's going to set us apart is the in-person workshops that we're offering these artisans. So when Manny goes out to all these festivals and recruits them, first thing we're going to do is we're going to give them an introductory class. We're going to teach them basic computer skills, because the sad truth is that in this day and age, a lot of adults still don't know how to use a computer. So once we get them up and running, we're going to help them create their marketplace. And after they're on their feet, we're going to introduce them to very introductory level courses. For example, an introduction to business management, which we're going to teach them what it is that makes a business successful. An introduction to finance, we're going to show them how money moves and how to make the most out of their investment. And as well as an introduction to marketing, so that they may improve their artistic brand. After a 90-day commitment period, we're going to offer advanced level courses. As you see up here, this is the framework for our curriculum. And our aim is to invest ourselves fully into our artisans to create a sense of loyalty, and as well as to help them expand their artistic brand to the most of their potential. Aside from the workshops, we're going to offer them monthly reviews. Now, what these reviews are going to incorporate, it's going to tell them what items are trending and not trending in the market. Why? So that they can tailor their online store to make the most amount of money they possibly can.
So what separates us from our competitors? Well, the first thing is the uniform, personalized way of packaging. Only Amazon offers something similar. And like Mariano was explaining, another thing that separates us are the workshops. Only we will be offering these workshops, which are hands-on workshops. We're really, the artisan will have the first time to learn a lot of using the computer and marketing and how to sell online. Another thing that separates us is that the workshop classes, they will be all in Spanish, but in English and Portuguese. So there are three different languages that we will be reaching to these artisans. And another thing that differentiates us is the participation in local festivals. Now, only in Miami-Dade alone, there's over 22 festivals celebrating the National Independence Day of the Latin American countries. So we plan on participating in as many as we can and marketing our brand and marketing the products of our customers. Now, these are very well-known companies, billion-dollar companies, so you probably all recognize their names. They're big competitors, but there's a problem for the artisans right now. When they are trying to sell in these websites, they are facing huge competition because there are thousands of sellers globally selling items very similar to theirs. So it's very difficult for them to separate themselves from those other sellers who may be charging less than they are or have a product that is very similar to theirs.
All right, so this brings us to our day-to-day operations. So as you see up here, this is our operational map, which is split into two different categories. On the left-hand side is our individual online sales, which is our online market, and on the right-hand side are our volume buyers, which are the big businesses such as cruise lines and wedding planners. So first thing we gotta do is we gotta go out and identify these artisans, as Manny mentioned before, at the festivals. Once we know who they are and who we're gonna be working with, they're gonna go ahead and create their online marketplace. This is gonna be their place to sell all their items, and now that the marketplace is running, they're gonna go ahead and list them. Items that they've already made, that they know that they sell, and that they know are trending are gonna be put in now. So now we're ready to receive an online order. Once that online order comes in, one of two things can happen. We can either ship it to the buyer if the item's in stock, or we also offer personalized items such as that sculpture you see in front of you now. This will give time for the artisan to create that product. Once it's ready to go, we're gonna ship it off to the buyer, and we're gonna encourage customer feedback. The reason being is we wanna do the best we can for our customers. Now let's talk about the volume buyers. Again, everything starts with our artisans. So once we have them, we're gonna go ahead and we're gonna become authorized vendor by signing all the necessary forms required. Once that's done, we're gonna make the items they request, whether it be hats, arts, jewelry, or whatever it may be. I'm gonna say I blanked out. Yeah. Now would be the time where they make it. So now we're ready to receive an online order. Once that online order comes in, we're gonna inventory them in our 20 by 20 storage space. We're gonna keep track of it using a SKU inventory system. The reason being, when an item comes in, we know exactly where it is and exactly where to find it. That way, when the online order comes in, we know where to get it and where to ship it, because the truth is that cruise lines are only in port for several hours. So it's a very small window that we have to meet in order to get the items to them on time. Once the item is shipped to them, again, we're gonna encourage customer feedback to improve our operation. So what opportunities do we find with this type of business? Well, it's appealing to both buyers and sellers alike. These items here is not something that you could buy at any retail store. Also, for sellers, it's a place for them to sell their items. It's a place for them to make a living. A lot of these people don't have jobs at the moment, so it gives them a place to make the money they need to support their families. We see that there are a few barriers of entry. And as Mark mentioned, there is competition, but it's relatively low. And also, since this is an online marketplace, it does offer, we do project a low amount of overhead.
If I could steal a moment of your time, I'd just like to mention that we're going to be based in Florida. We're choosing an LLC as our structure. We want to do that because we want to enjoy the limited liability that corporations get without paying the double taxation. We're going to hire a lawyer to draft our articles of agreement so we can get full control of our internal structure, which I realize was one of the hardest things for an LLC to do. And this way we won't have any limits on our subsidiaries or our shareholders. Thank you.
So now you've heard all the wonderful things that we're going to accomplish here at Artisans. Let's get down to the real reason why you want to hear, see finances. So what we're going to do is, with Artisans, like we mentioned, is low overhead. So really what we're targeting is computers for us to be able to update our website daily, weekly, monthly, depending on the needs. Laptops for when we do our workshops, we would normally be doing them at the artisans' homes in a personal one-to-one, or even in group settings. The other more important item that we need is a great camera to be able to take those high-quality pictures so when people see them on our website, it just calls out to them. The other thing is we need to be fully prepared for all of our festivals, so we definitely will need tents, signage, chairs, and tables to be able to stand out amongst the rest of the competition that's at these fairs. So when we're looking at revenue, the cruise lines is definitely going to be our largest revenue stream. Reason being is the majority of the artisans that we've spoken to said that if they can start selling more volume and sell more in bulk, they would definitely be able to give us these items at a much more wholesale price, which gives us more room for profit. The other one is the festivals. Like Mark had mentioned, there's 49 fairs and 22 festivals going on every single year in Miami-Dade County alone. We haven't even reached Broward County. So having the capabilities of attending all of these fairs and being able to personalize all of our items, depending on the culture event that we're at, or if it's a general event, will definitely give us advantage over the competition and give us a lot more revenue. The other one I want to talk to you about is our online store charge. Our online store charge is kind of taking the headache off the artisans. It's a $20 subscription fee every single month that covers all of their shipping, customer service fees, and anything else, and also help with the payment and the signage for personalizing for all of these festivals. So when we're looking at our projected profit and loss, Mariana had mentioned that we'd be occupying a 20 by 20 storage space. We would be looking at public storage. It normally is about $300 a month. The benefit is first month's only $1. So we get to save a little bit the first month. The other thing mentioned is our lawyer's fees. I did speak to a couple of attorneys. He mentioned to me for $2,500, and an additional $200 surcharge, he would put together all of our operational agreements, all the necessary bylaws, and put together all the necessary forms for us to form an LLC. Our first year, we are going to show a loss. It's about 14% because we're only working about 10 months out of the year. We're starting up in March. That is actually in very comparison to Etsy and Amazon. Etsy and Amazon, actually, for the last 3 years, have been showing a loss anywhere from 3 to 5%. A lot of it is due to expansion, but they are definitely showing a loss. The great news is coming in 2018, we are still showing a loss, but it's a little bit less. So we're doing a lot better with profits of 2, 5, and 9% in years 19, 20, and 21. When we're looking at our projected balance sheet, again, it is in line with what we're projecting for our profits and loss. Again, we are showing about a $20,000 loss in year one, a little bit less in year two with about $13,709. But the great news is it's from then on out, it's all profit. So when we talk about breaking even revenue, we thought about using break even units, we thought about break even everything. And the reality is this was our best route to go, and thanks to also the advice from our professor. Cruise lines, we really have no overhead. We are not purchasing these items up front. We are placing the order, receiving a wholesale price, and selling it for an upcharge, and still at more of a discount that they would find it in these festivals and place and source. So there's the greatest opportunity for profit. The reason why the cruise line one is because cruise lines, it's either a ship is 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, 7 days. So we're gonna have constant time to pick up and delivery, especially like how they had mentioned that it's about, they only have 8 hours. So we have an excess in gas consumption and time, which is the biggest commodity we have, and to try to resolve it. So with cruise lines, it's about $4,500. Festivals, it's a little bit less. It's less because it's standstill. They're not happening every single weekend, so we're not wasting that, we're not spending that money on gas, but we do have included in our expenses all of the average cost for most of the festivals and fairs here. The other one I want to talk about is online store charge again. $500 is what puts us pretty much at our break even. The benefit behind that, that's only about 25 people, artisans, which we plan to be on by year two. And anything above that, we're gonna use that money to reinvest into our business, into our artisans, and then maybe even give some back.
So throughout the semester, we spoke to several artisans and tried to get their feedback on how this business works. And they told us what would be better to improve, what they felt was missing. So out of all of the artisans we spoke to, this was one of the artisans who most stood out to us, as she was very honest about her the questions we gave her.
Absolutely. I definitely want to expand this from being just a side business right now to being my full-time career. I'd like to open up a store. I'm probably not, you know, franchise. I believe in local small businesses, and I'd like to keep them. Mostly Etsy and Instagram. And if I'm being honest, it really hasn't been that successful. There's such a saturation in the market for handcrafted jewelry, handcrafted, what have you, that it's kind of hard to break out from the pack and really see a profit. If you want to make a profit, you have to spend money on these little marketing things and send you ads for, like, pay, I don't know, how much to get followers, pay to be in the top page. I don't have the extra money to do marketing. I do my own marketing.
Convinced that there is a need out there. I really feel, just going around, and I've seen you guys do some research to sort of figure it out. So just me going around seeing all the artisans and seeing, and certainly knowing that they really don't have the capability or even the knowledge to market it. And I think I've given it a lot of thought in terms of organizing the workshop side of it to teach them how to do it, and also from the marketing side of it too as well. So congratulations on that. I was trying to figure out some of the revenue streams, and I was trying to figure out, so you have a subscription. You're saying something, I think I you said the subscription covers shipping?
Yes, USPS the way we came up with that number is USPS with the single box shipping that they have, the one, as long as it fits in a box, you can ship at the same price. They actually have a subscription fee, it's $5.99, and they can actually deliver next day as long as it's there by 5 p.m.
Because so, I'd imagine some of the stuff would need a little extra packing.
Well, yes, and it's one size shipping. You can choose up to, I think the box size was 10 by 12 inches.
Okay.
So as long as you can fit it in that box, 10 by 12, it will ship for the same price. It's an offer that they're doing to compete with UPS and FedEx to give local businesses that opportunity.
So it's shipping anywhere in the US, so to speak?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
The workshops, or let me probably talk about the inventory. Because you talked about a space and probably holding inventory. This would not be at your cost except for the space.
Correct.
Right, so the space is your cost.
Correct.
But the cost of the item actually goes back to the artisan.
So based on the workshops that you mentioned, when it's monthly, we're going to be doing what's trending, not only with what's going on online, but what's selling in the festivals and what's selling with the cruise lines also. So what we would keep in inventory based upon the orders would be something like the necklaces, where if we are, the way we've planned it out was, is once we would be charging these cruise lines 50% deposit upon delivery, net 15 days after that, we would take that deposit, and that's what we would use to pay the artisans. Now, if there are some pieces that have not been selling, we will definitely put them back on the website, or we will take them to festivals to be able to keep the sales cycle going. We don't want to keep anything in our warehouse for anything longer than a week to 2 weeks.
Are you taking a commission from the artist too as well on the sales, or just help me understand the
For example, the statue that you see in front of you, I'll give you that as an example. That statue right there is $25. Mm-hmm. When I asked the gentleman if you were selling, I asked him, how many are you selling on a regular basis? He says 1 to 2 every 2 weeks. I said, well, if you had the opportunity to sell those for, if you had the opportunity to sell 3 to 5 per week, would you lower the price? Definitely. He says, it cost me $11 to make that. He goes, I can sell it to you for the what it costs me, and you can sell it for whatever price you want, or maybe even a little bit of a markup. Because now, instead of him seeing 1 or 2 every 1 to 2 weeks, he's starting to see a consistent sale. So the majority of them were very open to lowering their prices if they can see more consistent sales. So that's where our revenue comes from.
Right. And the last thing I would throw out is the marketing. Mm-hmm. I wasn't sure if I saw marketing costs inside of it, because you realize you're building an e-commerce platform, you're doing some significant marketing that you'd have to do to support the artisans too as well. I wasn't sure if I saw the costs, I probably just missed it.
The good thing is that since our main marketing is going to come from social media, which is free. And our second biggest is going to be, or our biggest actually would be, word of mouth. We are going to pay for is the signage that we're going to be using at festivals, which is up here, and also the business cards.
And speaking of the business cards, one of the interesting things that we saw when we were going to these fairs was when we asked them if they had business cards, the majority of them did not have business cards. So we saw this as an opportunity to not only market the website, where people that are that want the item that they might not have anymore because they already sold, they can go on the website and through that card they can find the seller's name, and it will be easier for them to just buy it online.
Just in response to that, I mean, a lot of social media is free, mm-hmm. absolutely. But remember that the more targeted you get, is the more there is a cost to mm-hmm. it. So you know, if you're buying Facebook ads or you're doing any particular thing, then there comes a small cost. But I won't take up all the time.
Just to clarify, we are doing as much free marketing as we can, and whatever costs, say man hours, we're not touching targeted ads, but man hours are already calculated into our sellers.
Awesome.
And also the tents. Your name's on the tents.
The signage is right there. And to answer your question with the website, with Wix.com, we're going to start with somebody else hosting our website. Their premium package is $25 a month. Mm-hmm. Okay? And just to touch upon, we are going to be also using the power of hashtags. While you do say that targeted marketing is going to be get costly, Miami itself, with hashtags itself, will attract a lot more people to your website, to your Facebook page, to your Instagram, just by clicking on a little hashtag.
I mean, localizing it, the diversity that's in Miami already makes it exotic in terms mm-hmm. of yes. the, mm-hmm. The quality of what you have. So I think you're on to something.
Thank you.
I have a couple, I know you're short, so I'm going to go really fast. I think there's definitely a need. My mother-in-law is a local artisan. She made my bracelet. And she's in her 70s, and obviously she needs help. And she goes to her grandchildren for help, you know? So there is definitely a need. My question is, how do you qualify to be an artisan? Because you can't get everybody, because everybody's stuff is not going to sell.
Well, we're looking at people who are living either in poverty, are above a certain age where they can't work anymore because they were forced to retire, they had a workplace injury, any sort of things that just, it doesn't allow, they can't go out to the real, to not the real world, but out to the business place and make a living for themselves. So we're looking to target those people that need that helping hand.
And also within the artisan community themselves, again, word of mouth is the most powerful advertising tool we have here. I alone come from a family of 227. My grandmother's 100, she's got 28 great-grandchildren.
Wow.
Yes. Okay. That's what she married into. So word of mouth marketing is just being able to hear the opportunities that we've been able to present to them is what will be able to give us to be able to reach out to more people who do have this quality, these skills, and have the passion to do this. Yes, okay, good.
So I just wanted to go back to the cruise line situation.
Okay.
Right? So you're targeting cruise lines for them to retail your products within the ship.
Yeah.
Yes.
But, you know, are you going to be selective with where the cruise line is going? Because if they're going to Nassau, they're going to another island, the first thing that comes to mind for me is I'd rather get it locally right there at Nassau in the market when I get there. Right?
Well, correct. And the thing with the stores on site, the cruise lines, if you've noticed, they are normally open the shops after you've left the country where you've been. Mm-hmm. So if you've maybe missed the opportunity, for example, Coral Gables right now has a huge influx of Bahamian population. Mm-hmm. So to be able to sell them the products depending on their schedule is definitely a route that we're going to go.
Right. Because there are cruise lines that were like Viking that's going someplace completely different, that's mm-hmm. colder, right?
Yeah.
That's not the case. Right. So, last question, the wedding planner
mm-hmm.
situation.
Yes.
Could you explain to me why you would consider them a target market for wholesale?
There are over 261 weddings a year in Miami alone.
Right.
Okay. They spend on average just on favors, because you have a lot of cross-cultural marriages happening here in Miami,
mm-hmm.
or people who are having destination weddings here.
Mm-hmm.
They're spending anywhere from $164 to $200 per wedding just on favors. Like you would see over there, there's a little bride and groom sitting on the table.
Mm-hmm.
I've worked for a catering company. I've seen the weddings that go on here. To be able to attract that market, to be able to give people the opportunity to see, to take home a gift from somewhere where they've been, or from, I can give you my personal experience. My wife is Italian, Sicilian, I am Cuban. So when we went up there, the person who makes the little cookies that are there, something that falls with the Italian culture, was a huge sell, huge hit. Everybody wants to know where they can get them and where they could find them. So we find that the weddings will be a huge market for us to penetrate here, because the amount of people that want to get married.
So you're going to target artists who create those miniature items
to sell. Just to give you an example, if you don't mind. So, like I said, this all comes apart.
Mm-hmm.
So you can do, they can do something like this, a little conga with cube on it.
Mm-hmm.
Or they can do a little purse with Miami on it. Mm-hmm. Stuff that can be personalized so that mm-hmm. that way they can be able to sell it, not sell it, but give it to their guests at the wedding.
So the website.
Here's your example.
Listen, I already have it sold. You break it, you bought it. That wasn't supposed to come apart. No, it does come apart. That was supposed to happen.
Yeah. It has different body.
Yes.
Yeah. You can
arms, the arms, the torso, the bottom, and the log and the head actually come apart. Yes. Everything comes apart.
Oh, man, I totally forgot my question.
Thank you.
Time's up, by the way.
Okay, so you're going to be, I guess this would be your niche, because Etsy is not promoting their vendors, their retailers.
No,
right?
Etsy.
So you're going to be providing a niche by promoting wedding
correct.
Trinkets on the site, in addition to, you know, grassroots reaching out to these.
Correct.
Okay. And you're also going to be promoting, so you're going to have a tent at the festival
mm-hmm.
with different products from multiple clients.
Tailor-made to those festivals.
Right.
So if it was a Cuban festival, we would take this one for sure.
Right.
And if it was a Brazilian, we would just ask the artisan to do something from Brazil and colors from that country.
So you had a list of things that made the differentiators, right?
Correct.
So what's actually different from you
regarding Etsy, because I feel like Etsy is your real competitor in this particular scenario, because of when I think Etsy, I think eclectic, I think artistic. I don't think that way when I think of Amazon, right?
Okay.
I think of Walmart online. Mm-hmm. And so the difference, your niche is that you are taking ownership of promoting, marketing, and selling the product, which is the difference from mm-hmm. Etsy. And so when you present in the future,
yep.
you need to make that one of the very first thing or one of the very first pitches, like the front side of your pitch.
Okay.
So when you start to tell me about what Etsy is, let me know that this is my niche.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to take on your product and I'm going to take it into the market here in South Florida.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, that's actually very true.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right, I know overtime.
Any other questions?
I don't
well, and just can I just touch upon one thing that you mentioned? You mentioned about Etsy. The last time you went on Etsy and you searched bracelets, how many items came up? 3,000?
I don't remember. The last time I was on Etsy was for a friend's something, like it was my friend
wedding?
Was doing a party. It wasn't a wedding. It was a party. And she wanted, you know, different artistic things, and so that's the last time. But I'm not the Walmart girl. I'm not
well, and that's what I just want to touch upon. If you were to enter bracelet, you would probably get about 5,000 results. And of those 5,000, you probably see the same item multiple times on multiple pages.
Mm-hmm.
So how do we separate ourselves from Etsy? Is that it's taking away that oversaturation of products that's going on. Is as you can see from all the items that we have brought here, no two items are really the same.
Mm-hmm.
So being able to give that personalized touch and feel is something that would definitely separate us from Etsy.
Right, but if I am looking for someone to help me
mm-hmm.
sell my product, it's going to matter more to me that you are going to cruise lines, going to wedding
yes.
planners, going to festivals
mm-hmm.
to help sell my product
mm-hmm.
because.
Right.
If I'm in the LMI community, if I'm in the low to middle income community,
mm-hmm.
and you're helping me sell my product,
yes.
that matters way more to me than, you know, Etsy having this huge database of products.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Absolutely.
So I'd be more willing to go to you for that reason alone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Perfect. No, I thank you very much. I really appreciate that. That's very true. Any other questions?
Food allergy is a growing public health concern. Nearly 6 million children have food allergies. The economic cost of children's food allergies is nearly $25 billion a year. Our allergy-friendly bakery will be offering delicious, inexpensive desserts to Miami Title I schools in Miami-Dade County that are free of ingredients such as peanuts, tree nuts, and eggs that cause a severe allergic reaction. We are Yummalicious.
Okay, good evening, everyone. My name is Hannah Khan.
Miriam Negrin.
Geneva Ramirez.
And we are Yummalicious. Now, who are we? Yummalicious is a bakery that produces desserts that are free of peanuts, tree nuts, and egg ingredients. Now, our mission. Yummalicious is a committed team of knowledgeable individuals brought together to promote the awareness of allergies within foods. Now, this is done by providing healthy desserts free of certain allergens to give every individual an opportunity to indulge guilt-free, especially within the lower income communities. Now, our vision is to create indulgent desserts that are healthy for every individual, including those with allergies. Now, I'm gonna hand it over to Miriam so she can tell you a story on the inspiration behind the business.
Our inspiration is my grandson that he's 8 years old, and since he was an infant, he's been allergic to different foods. But when he was about 6 months old, I was carrying him, and I just kissed him on the cheek, and my lips were imprinted on his cheek right away, and they got very swollen. So we got very scared, called the doctor, and then he was tested for different food allergy. After that, what came was the family getting instructed, and we got educated how to handle mm-hmm. a child with severe allergies. We learned how to use an EpiPen, we have to wash our hands, our mouth before touching him, and his siblings also have to do the same thing. now Hannah is going to continue.
Okay, so now I'm going to give you some statistics on allergy. Now, these findings are based on the United States as a whole. We cannot find specific statistics on Florida and Miami-Dade County alone. Now, there are 15 million Americans that suffer from food allergies. This means roughly 9 million adults and 6 million children. Every 3 minutes, a food allergy reaction sends someone to the hospital. Following the ingestion of the food allergen, a person with food allergies can experience severe and life-threatening allergic reaction called anaphylaxis. Now, this reaction can lead to constricted airways of the lungs, severe lowering of blood pressure and shock, and suffocation by the swelling of the throat. Now, each year in the United States, it is estimated that anaphylaxis within food results in 3,000 emergency room visits, 2,000 hospitalizations, and roughly about 150 deaths per year. Now, 8 foods account for 90% of all reactions: milk, eggs, peanuts, tree nuts, soy, wheat, fish, and shellfish. Even trace amounts of food allergen can cause a reaction. So as our business, we want to steer away from the peanut, tree nut, and egg ingredients. Now our management team. Our management team is composed of 3 equal owners. We have the financial manager and co-owner, which is Geneva. We have the marketing manager and co-owner, which is myself. And we have the head baker and co-owner, Miriam. Okay, for our demographic area. For our business, we are going to be renting a warehouse. This warehouse is going to allow us to bake our goods and administer to the schools. Now for our, what we want to do is partner with the schools within Miami-Dade County. And we want to sell to them in bulk so they can administer to their students. However, we want to focus on a specific group. We want to focus on the Title I schools. Now, the Title I schools have the highest population of low-income students that come from low-income families. 60% or more of the students qualify for free or reduced lunch, which zones them into the Title I school. Now, we want to focus within the Cutler Bay area, and we've chosen 5 schools to begin with. We're choosing Miami Southridge Senior High School, Caribbean K-8 Center, Cutler Bay Academy, Gulfstream Elementary School, and Dr. Edward Wiggum Elementary School. Now also, as I said, we are going to be renting a warehouse. So we want to branch out and try to serve the schools around our area as well. So we picked schools within a 5-mile radius to kind of, I'd say branch out again and reach out to students who may also suffer from food allergies as well. So these 2 schools are Richmond Heights Middle School and Heritage K-8 Center.
So as Hannah mentioned, we have, in total, we have 7 schools that we will be servicing, of which 5 of them are Title I in the Miami area schools. And then the 2 remaining schools are schools within a 5-mile radius of our actual warehouse. So we calculated and we projected that out of the 7 schools, we will have 5,750 students. And out of each student, we project at least 2 items per student per week will be ordered. So in total, that will be about 11,500 items that we will sell per week. Now, we will be baking a total of 13,200 items a week. Deducting the amount of items we will be selling per week, it gives us an excess of 1,700 items that we will be selling on the weekend. We will be going to craft shows, we will be attending sports games, and then we also have our online sales that we need to fill those orders as well.
Okay, for our competition, we have 3 main competitors. Our 3 main competitors are Kelly Family Bakery, Bunny Cakes, and Peace Egg Cake. Now, Kelly Family Bakery produces several items that are free of allergens. Bunny Cakes produces vegan items for their consumers, and Piece of Cake produces vegan items as well, and they specialize in their muffins. Now, Kelly Family Bakery, one, offering a lot of their items are very overpriced, and for our business, we want to focus on the lower income communities, so we're going to be selling our items at a much lower price. They have overpriced items, and they only serve prepackaged cupcakes when our cupcakes are made from scratch. Now, Bunny Cakes, their baked goods can be cross-contaminated with tree nuts because of their facility. they use several ingredients. So you, when you're baking and you're trying to be free of certain allergens, you have to make sure that, you know, you have a set place for it. Like our bakery, we're focusing on three ingredients that we can produce, like we can make all of our goods in one setting, you know. So that's one of their cons. And then Piece of Cake, they only have online orders. Their prices are extremely high as well, and they only distribute to local stores. Now, none of our competitors serve within the lower income communities, and none of them will be partnering with the schools as we wish to. Now, for our marketing plan, we would like to use word of mouth. First of all, word of mouth is a really popular tool, especially within the bakeries and stuff like that. We have our online website. Now, our online website, we are going to be taking orders because of our excess products that we have. We're also going to be using that for advertising. Now, blogging. Our head baker here is going to be using WordPress, which is a free form of blogging. She's going to be posting web recipes, as well as using YouTube, a free source video blogging, to record herself conducting these recipes and reaching out to the parents within our low-income communities. We're going to be taking advantage of our free social networking sites, which is Twitter and Instagram, and we're going to be using the Facebook ads as well. We're going to be conducting cooking lessons with the parents of the schools. We're going to do it one time per month, and it's relatively simple. We're going to take one of our items that we make, and we're going to teach the parents how to do it. That way, when they, you know, we want to spread the awareness, you know, you can make healthy and really, really good dessert options that are free of allergens, so you don't have to worry about allergic reactions. And we're also going to be hiring a social marketing specialist to further help us promote our business. Now, Yummalicious is a limited liability corporation. Being an LLC, we'll protect our personal assets from any possible claims made against our business. Oh, I apologize. And now I'm going to pass it along to Miriam, and she will discuss our facility.
Our facility is located in the West Kendall area, and it's very convenient for the South Dade. The Title I schools are located in the South District because they are distributed by South, North, and West of Miami, so we can expand. And as you can see, the facility is ready, and we just had to purchase an oven to do our baking. Weekly operation, 5 days a week, we're gonna make deliveries to the schools, the Color Bay area and our two schools in Kendall. And we will be serving a total of 5,750 students. We'll also be selling our sports games, like after school, and also on the weekends. We are also gonna be selling through on the website, and any events within Miami, we're also gonna be there selling our baked goods. Our daily operation starts processing all the school orders. Then we start preparing, getting our items to do the mixing and everything else. Then we bake our goods, decorate them, package them, and get them ready to deliver to the schools. We sanitize the warehouse, and then we just do inventory for the next day. We're gonna be baking six days out of the week, since we don't need to do so much. We're gonna have an extra day for other things. And we start at 6 o'clock in the morning baking. And we're gonna start with our special cupcakes that have no milk and no eggs. So this way that cupcake doesn't get contaminated when we start using the milk. Then we're gonna do the rest of the cupcakes. And our muffins is an oatmeal muffin that is low in calories, only 102 calories. And we also do apple muffin, oatmeal muffin, and chocolate, that one's not that healthy. You know? But chocolate is also known to be good for us too. So we and we go on with baking our cookies. And our daily schedule is doing the deliveries. Now we're gonna have a driver that's gonna be doing the delivery. We're not gonna be doing the delivery. And we also hire a baker, to an assistant baker. Our menu, as I said, we have the cupcakes, vanilla and chocolate cupcakes. The judges today have a combination of vanilla and chocolate. So you can have both. So you can enjoy both of them at the same time. And we have the ones that have no milk. And we have our special signature cookies. That's a special recipe done by me and my grandkids. And we have chocolate chip sugar cookies and gingerbread cookies. Now the gingerbread cookies, we also, the gingerbread cookies have molasses, and molasses is known to have a lot of properties that are good for you. So most bakeries do not have gingerbread cookies all year round. We do, we just have it differently for Christmas, but we have it all year round. And then I already talked about our muffins. And Geneva's going to tell you about our financial.
So the startup funds for our business, we calculated that with $50,000, we would be able to open up our business. The personal investments that we agreed to would be $10,000 from each of us, the co-owners, bringing it to $30,000. And then along with that, we each took out a personal loan of 7.8% interest for 4 years, totaling to $20,000, bringing it up to the $50,000 that we agreed for a startup business. The break-even point. The break-even point analysis, with the careful examination of the calculation of our revenues and associated costs, allowed me to get a margin of safety that would be good for our business. So in the cupcake section, you can see that the chocolate cupcake, we would need to sell the most to be able to break even. On the muffins, we have the oatmeal and the apple muffin, which we would have to sell 70 to break even. And then in the cookies, we have this special Yummalicious cookie, which is a lot smaller than the regular size cookie that we have, and we have to sell 400 of them. And as a matter of fact, each one of the judges, everybody up front, has the special Yummalicious cookies, and you can feel free to try them because they're delicious. They yeah. really are. They're one of a kind.
I'll just double check with Kenya.
So in our profit and loss, we show the first year, 2018 fiscal year, a net profit of $349,000, giving us a net profit percentage of 40%. The following year, the fiscal year 2019, it is at $375,000, a net profit percentage at 42%. As you can see also, our revenues, year over year, we have a conservative 3% increase year over year. So our future plans. Our future plans, with the cash on hand of fiscal year 2018 being $352,000, we plan on adding new items to our menu. We plan on obtaining a new retail location, and then also we want to partner with other schools to be able to expand our customer base. Along with that, we would like to award scholarships to the Title I Miami schools in total of 30 scholarships for $1,000 each. We hope that the students that do receive these awards that one day they would pursue cooking and baking and perhaps go to a prestigious school like Johnson & Wales, perhaps. We would like to also plan to purchase the warehouse that we rent, and to purchase it, it would be $200,000. And then also we would need, if we're, our business is expanding, we would also need to purchase industrial equipment, which would help us in to keep up with the demand. So the impact matrix would, these are the metrics that we are going to use to measure and track what will impact our business. The number of students within the Title I schools is definitely something that we need to keep track of and measure. The number of parents that attend the free training Title I schools as well. Number of food items donated to the Title I schools. The scholarships that we're awarding to the Title I schools, the number of hits that we will receive on the YouTube teaching videos, and then also the number of hits on the blog regarding allergies. So now I would like to leave you with our conclusion, and this is the testimonial of Miriam's daughter and her grandson. Which, in fact, is the reason why we started our business.
My son is 8 years old, and he has had multiple food allergies since he was an infant. The biggest challenge is definitely eating at a restaurant, but even birthday parties and school events end up being a stressful situation. All cupcakes and other treats contain at least one ingredient that he's allergic to. And although he takes his own dessert or snack, of course he feels left out, never being able to eat the same thing that all his friends are eating. There aren't many allergen-friendly dessert options available that are both affordable and delicious.
And that concludes our presentation.
Questions?
I'm going to start. I think that your company is aptly named because I had two of the cookies and they were certainly yummalicious. So I love that.
Thank you.
I see a lot of opportunities for you. When I was doing this, there are so many opportunities because you could partner with the USDA because they have several programs that go into underserved communities and provide schools for aftercare, you know, so you could partner with them. You could also partner with the magnet schools in Dade County, often that are in underserved communities that have the culinary tracks. That's another way to partner. So I really think, and I want you to blog, because I think you have a story, and I think there's a lot of people that you could reach for that, okay? It was a great presentation.
Thank you.
In fact, I would certainly agree on that. I had a chocolate chip. Is that the one with the most calories? It was really very good. So compliments on that. And clearly, I guess there is a need. I really wasn't aware too much of it because I guess I don't have too much of that in my own circumstances. But if it is then that you will need to sell, do you need to sell a school this? Do you have to go in and make a sales pitch to the school?
No. We already partnered with a school system.
Okay.
And we already have all the information to be a lobbyist for the school.
Awesome.
and to be able to sell. And what we do is they make orders and we deliver once a week.
Awesome. My only other question was, do you need certification licenses to have a commercial kitchen or something like that? I wasn't sure about that. Mm-hmm. And what cost that would be, I wasn't sure I saw that inside of it. I'm not sure I would buy a warehouse that quickly. I feel as if, you could sort of plow the money back into the business to sort of build
that
it
good
up.
Feedback.
But I really think it sounds like a great idea.
We're actually going into between buying the warehouse or maybe buying a local bakery. So this way people can go in and like buy and sit
right.
down. And
we want to slowly
because
no, expand.
Your revenue stream is online and through schools. I didn't hear a retail
right.
front, right?
No, we don't.
No,
have
our our retail will be selling at the
craft fairs, on the weekend,
at sports activities, because most kids have like baseball, soccer, after school, and that we will take our truck there.
Okay.
Basketball games.
Were there salaries? I wasn't sure if I saw. Were you guys paying yourselves to us?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
we're $35,000 each. And then we have the driver and the
assistant baker. And then we also have a cleaning person as well.
That's right. I know Anna is from a food.
We actually have a commercial kitchen. But you guys found a commercial kitchen where you needed to be, so that's going to be great. But when it comes to the public school system, I know that it's a bidding process, right? You're competing
right.
with other vendors.
Correct.
That, and in hopes of winning the bid.
Right.
Right? So the barriers to entry for the schools that you listed, you know, could basically, let's say you win the bid for this year and you don't win it the next, there goes your business. So Rob mentioned, I think it was Lynn, mentioned targeting charter schools within the LMI community because they have less barriers to entry.
That's true.
Instead of, and I say still get in line, you know, still bid for a space, but don't let that become your main source of income. Since it's not a reliable source. It's not, like if you build a relationship with a charter school that's privately owned, you build that relationship, you have a better opportunity than to attempt to target the public school system, which has multiple barriers to
Right. That would allow us to partner and continue to partner with them.
Right. The only thing is that the school system does not have anything that offers allergy free. They do not offer allergy free desserts.
Unfortunately, you know, you would have to you'd have to teach your customer, you'd have to get in front of the ones who make that decision, which would be superintendents, not the actual school, right?
Right.
But your back door would be after school programs. After school programs that have rented the space at the school where you could target these nonprofit organizations, where you're able to get your products that way, right? And even speak to them about educating the parents through their program. And that way, when it comes time to bid for your products, parents can back you in addition to work.
That's what we eventually wanted to do. Like as the years go by, we wanted to, one, broaden and, you know, enlarge the number of schools that we are, you know, going to be working with. But after school program was definitely a big thing too.
Right, because there are a few, I can't remember the names, but there are a few that are funded. I don't know if we're still gonna have funding for
that. The Royal Academy is one of them.
Right, but there are a few nonprofit and for-profit organizations that rent out the space in every public school.
Yes.
As soon as school is over, you know, there are latchkey kids whose parents won't pick them up. Public schools, that's where it's happening. So those programs, that's your start. Your start is there, and the last advice would be to pay for the addresses of the family members who live in that area so you can promote locally. So reach out to Dun and Bradstreet, find out what the quote would be to get a listing, and they'll give you zip code, they'll give you the number of people in the household, they'll give you race, gender, they'll break it down for you. It'll probably cost you like $3,000 to $5,000 depending on how many households you would like. And instead of being B2B, include B2C. Target the parents that are sending their kids to that school directly in addition to after school programs in the charter school.
Great.
Thank you. Okay. That's a great
feedback.
You can target me too.
Aren't they good?
And the licenses, we're getting a certificate of use from Miami-Dade County, where you're getting the tax license.
And you also have to go to the health department.
And we also have to go to the health
department.
To go
over the kitchen to confirm that you can bake. The ceiling doesn't have water and all that good stuff.
Right, yeah. And we also need a grease trap permit from the environmental department.
Well, as long as I get more cookies.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have announcements.
Yes. Hi, my name is Gustavo Grande. I'm program manager for the Idea Center. The Idea Center is located in Walsall campus, and it's the innovation hub for all of you, all the students of Miami-Dade College. For those that don't know about the Idea Center, we have some entrepreneurial programs, and one of them is the Startup Challenge. The Startup Challenge just opened their applications, and it's a 12-week program where at the end you're gonna have a pitch competition in order to be able to win $5,000 in prizes. So for all these teams that have great ideas, they can apply and participate in the 12-week program with different workshops. You're gonna receive also mentoring. So at the end you can compete for $5,000 in prizes, which will be seed funding for many of the initiatives that you guys need in order to start this up. So if any of you are interested in participating or applying, just come to me and ask me any questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. And the winner is Endless Possibilities. Yvette was in Brazil.
Oh, okay.
And she called me 4 times from Brazil. For the mock presentation, she did the mock presentation through Skype or
FaceTime.
And she dressed up for that.
I was in the hotel room like at 1 in the morning, like with a suit.
So thank you guys, it's been a pleasure. The other groups, you know, you all of you did so good. You put your heart and soul into it. We went through this process for 3 months, right? There were times I know you couldn't sleep. I couldn't sleep either. there have been many of those times. You have the future ahead of you. You're going to graduate soon, right? Don't be sad if you didn't win tonight.
No.
You all show so much knowledge. So, would you like to, since this is the social entrepreneurship course and this is the second time we are doing this. So last time what happened, the students, they came in the front and they were giving us feedback. Like what, you know, how was the process? What did they feel? What did they learn through this process? Would you like to tell us a little bit about it? The social entrepreneurship part.
I can see
to the camera.
Talk to the camera.
Talk to the camera, okay. Or talk to us.
I think, it gave us all an opportunity to find something that we're passionate about and put our time and energy into that. Walking into this, I didn't have any idea of what I was going to be doing or what impact I could make. And 3 months, we're on a different path, going a completely different direction. I didn't see myself going personally. So it's all a blessing.
I'm going to jump in what Ariel said, and I was discussing this with Ariel and Chris earlier, that I didn't know anybody that had suffered from substance abuse. until this project. And now I know like three or four. And I keep telling them this is like the best kept little secret, because you don't know that your neighbor, like I didn't know my son's tutor had almost lost her son to drug addiction. And this is why she got her certification in CAP. And now when she heard about this, she's like, I'm there from day one. And we will pay her. And I said, oh, Maria, we'll pay you. She goes, that's a plus. But she's willing to come in as a volunteer. And she's already providing us with recommendations
with how you were saying earlier, like getting connections with different rehab programs, like going directly to be the post-rehab program for
This other doctor that is a good friend of hers, and he's opening rehabilitation clinics, and she told me he's a good friend of mine. She gave me his number and name and said, call him and tell him I recommended you, and you can start networking with him, and I'm going to pass those numbers on to Chris. And I was telling Chris, I may not go over there and play basketball because that's not much I can do. I can help administratively, but that I feel that talking through her, with her about this, I've had a calling to maybe be an advocate.
Awesome.
It's crazy how we really have no idea about the situation. You know, the more you start looking into it, the more you start researching into it, and you start seeing these numbers, and it's like real, real, real eye-opening. You start looking at different companies that start making these pharmaceutical drugs, and like it's just so crazy how it works out. So I've learned a lot. I'm excited to get started, and yeah,
let's do it. I like to say something. So it would be interesting if you had been there from the beginning of the class and see just how wild the ideas started out to what they actually became. And still at the beginning, I remember thinking, how in the world are they ever going to make that idea make money and also serve the purpose? And then, of course, you know, everybody was just amazing and being able to draw it all together to get there. And of course, a lot of help from the professor, a lot of knowledge. We helped each other out a few times, I think. Everybody in the class, it was just a great experience. Thank you.
I find it the most fascinating, because when you think of coming up with a business plan, you don't think numbers, you think money. But the fact that you find a social need and how you can impact either someone's life or different people, to me, the social entrepreneurship aspect, I found the most rewarding and the most fascinating.
And it was also, I really, really like the fact that, like, normally it doesn't really happen, but, like, I don't know, like, our Sunday meetings, like, I enjoyed them, you know?
You know, every Sunday, 2 o'clock.
Like, that's what we're doing. Like, it's just, you get so used to doing it that it's like, okay, we're not doing Sunday.
Yvette's been doing group projects with me throughout the program, and she, the most relieved she is tonight, not that she passed the course, is that she doesn't have to deal with me every day.
When we started this, whether to do a regular type of capstone or the social entrepreneurship, and you don't really realize what's going on in the community unless you get out there and start pounding the pavement and see what's going on. And that's part of the reason why I think, at least for myself, chose to go the social entrepreneurship side, because like Dara mentioned, you don't know what's going on with your next door neighbor. When we spoke to over 20 different people who were making these products, some that were a little bit higher end, and just to give you an idea, you know those little blocks you see in Bayside? They're about $6,000 a month for 10 square feet of space for you to be able to rent. And people are killing themselves to make it that. And then I see I have my car, I have a roof over my head, I have a paycheck, steady paycheck coming in every week, and it's just, you realize that there's so much more you can do. Rather than reaching out globally, start locally, start with your community, see how else you can help out. And I mean, this class for me, my poor wife, you know, I had to put her through a lot.
Not just this class.
No,
being polite.
Yeah, exactly.
But no, a great thanks to the professor, to the rest of our classmates who gave us great, we all gave each other feedback when we were doing the 1,001 different types of presentations. You know, that everybody was open-minded and willing to accept that other people's opinions, and you know, to anybody else who was a part of, at least for our group, to allow us to be as successful as we did. So thank you.
So there were some very, very candid and open moments in that class, right? There were times
yes.
when we were very open about the issues we are facing, right? And you know, thank you for trusting each other. It takes a lot to say, well, you know, I observed this struggle or I have faced this struggle. Thank you for, you know, making it comfortable for everybody, right? And thank you for trusting me in that process.
That time is hard.
thank you for, you know, coming with me in this amazing journey. I mean, this is the most rewarding course I teach. This is the most rewarding experience I have. I see this amazing transition from, you know, remember when you started this program and when you went through this program, you talked about pocket fencing and so on. We don't talk about that anymore. It's there. It has to be there, right? We have to make the business sustainable. But now we are more aware of this. Thank you for being open.
Thank you.
Three. Perfect.